Google is about starting conversations with data and trying to start with some basic scientific observations and getting the measurements right. And I think that's one of the things that you guys could be proudest of, is that you started from a fact basis as opposed to an emotional one. Robert, do you want to sort of introduce everybody?
I'm Robert Stone. I'm the producer and director of the film. This is Stewart Brand, Gwyneth Cravens, Mark Lynas, Michael Schellenberger, all of whom started off being very anti-nuclear.
The view that we all sort of came to in our own ways is that cheap, clean energy is arguably the most important thing from a human development and an environmental perspective. From a cheap, clean energy, everybody in the world can have, you know, medicines, they can have clean water, they can have longer lifespans, healthier lives, and you can use that energy then to grow more food on less land, letting more of nature go back to wilderness. This is why Bill Gates says cheap, clean energy is sort of the biggest human development goal of the 21st century.
The most energy-efficient way to live is right on the edge of desperate poverty. In the favelas and slums of the world, there are people who are really using very, very little material and very, very little energy. They are so green, and they are so eager to stop being that kind of green. And the main economic and demographic event in the world now is people are getting the hell out of poverty all over the world. Where you've been traveling, I think you're seeing this. And even in the most desperate slums, people are in those desperate slums back, rather than back in the village, because in the village they were stuck. In town they've got a shot, and they're taking that shot. And you'll see wires everywhere because they need electricity to do all the stuff that means being part of a city. But as you're finding in Pakistan and elsewhere, if it's uneven, if it's unreliable electricity, then everything slows down. School slows down, medicine slows down.
If you can get the 1 billion richest people in the world to cut their energy consumption in half, to get the other 7 or 8 billion people up to that standard, you're still going to have to triple or maybe quadruple global energy consumption. So the math actually doesn't work out.
The fact that we've got enough mined uranium and spent fuel already to run the entire country at 80 gigawatts, which is its current energy consumption, for 500 years is interesting. And you could run the US for 1,000 years on stuff that's already sitting around in junkyards in Kentucky. You know, we don't have a fundamental energy shortage, which is the complete reverse of the way we've always had this discussion. Why do you need to conserve energy and switch everything, you know, or say to Chinese that they can't have standards of living that we've all become? You know, there is no shortage of energy. We've just got to accept that we're going to use different technologies. The reality is that since the anti-nuclear movement really came up in the early 1970s, maybe a bit earlier, the US has invested in 150 new coal-fired power stations. So every single nuclear plant that was proposed and then canceled because of anti-nuclear activism either was replaced by a coal plant right there, and in some places they actually tore out the places where the reactors were going to put, and they put coal boilers in the exact same locations, or somewhere else. And so the environmental movement has made the world safe for coal, unintentionally, of course, and somehow now has to look to a future where they want to eliminate coal, just as the rest of the world, Asia, China, India, so on, are getting to the standard of living, or hoping to get to the standard of living and energy consumption that the US and everyone else put in some time ago.
We're starting to realize real costs for not dealing with climate change. I mean, the Hurricane Sandy, I think, has cost $60 billion. You know, what if we get another one next year? You know, I mean, that could happen. The catastrophic pollution that's going on in Beijing right now. There are costs that are starting to emerge from not tackling this problem.
A lot of the environmental movement that took shape then was one leftist and two romantic. It was part of the hippie counterculture thing, which I was part of. And so ideology and romanticism encourage you to basically have a narrative and a few notions, and then everything fits into that narrative. It doesn't work with climate change. With climate change and with greenhouse gases, you've got to work back from the solution. My fellow environmentalists have this romantic attachment to a certain view of the world, which does not fit with actually dealing with the engineering problem.
But isn't there another problem, which is people are loath to change their minds and admit that they were wrong, and you all each actually in the movie say, this is what I thought, some new data came along and I changed my mind?
Well, this is the difference between science.
No, you don't agree with that. Go ahead.
This is the difference between evidence-driven and ideology-driven. Is ideology, you double down on your theory of the world, even though it's wrong.
Most documentaries function and are marketed and have a life out in the world by reinforcing people's preconceptions about the world. What we've done here with this movie is to take a different tack. It's not like coming at you in your face and saying, oh, you're wrong, this is why you're wrong. It's we are you, and we were wrong about some things, and we were wrong for a whole variety of reasons because we were given information that was wrong. And so it takes you on a journey. But what I found, and this was one of the surprises that came out of showing it at Sundance, is that it's actually converting, like it's like in a religious conversion. It's actually a really, I don't know if the right word is enjoyable, but it's a cathartic experience. It's actually a more satisfying experience than being told what you already believe. Like that's nice to be told, oh, I'm right. But it's actually even more exhilarating to have your mind change, to change your mind, to come to your own conclusions about something based on new information. You have to look at the worst case scenarios that have happened with even the most ridiculously designed reactor ever built, which is the one at Chernobyl. The worst case scenario turns out to be not the apocalypse that we all thought it was. I trust the United Nations and the World Health Organization that's done the definitive studies on this, and their conclusion is that Chernobyl has killed 56 people, which was probably the most astonishing fact I came across in making the whole film. So if you look at all of the various ways that we produce energy and figure out the deaths per terawatt, how many people die per unit of energy produced. Nuclear is the second safest after wind. It's even safer than solar panels, as we point out in the film.
Because people fall off the solar panels.
It's actually, making solar panels is a toxic process.
Really?
The materials of cadmium, lithium, and all these things, right? So the safety thing, we can obviously make reactors much safer, and we show that in the film, new types of reactors that are passively safe, that don't have all these redundancies built into them because they're inherently unsafe. But even the reactors that are these gargantuan things that were sort of a crazy thing to be built anyway, have turned out to be remarkably safe.
I just wanted to add one thing that changed my mind about nuclear power, which was visiting nuclear plants and other nuclear facilities and nuclear waste repositories and so on. Seeing it for yourself, you realize how many barriers there are between the public and the radioactive material. And if people were more used to these plants, which look formidable in the distance because of their giant cooling towers and stuff, if people were educated early on about how nuclear power worked and what radiation can and cannot do, I think that would help significantly.
Well, one of the main stories in the film is the development of the integral fast reactor, which was a reactor that was developed in the late 80s and early 90s in the United States, where they set out to really solve a lot of the basic problems with nuclear power. And the one of the key ones was safety. And this was a reactor that was, they tried to melt it down. We have film of it, and those of you who haven't seen the film, there's film of them trying to melt the thing down twice. They ran through shutting off all of the safety devices, just letting the thing completely run wild and sitting back, not touching anything, not touching the dials, and the thing just passively shut itself down. As it got hotter, the reactivity diminished and it shut itself down. So this was a reactor that we developed that does have these kind of advanced passive safety devices or designs that are part, sort of a central part of fourth generation reactors, and it was killed really for political reasons. So nobody here, is advocating us ever building the kinds of reactors that caused Chernobyl or caused Fukushima or anything like that. What we're advocating for is innovation and R&D on advanced designs that don't have these kind of problems.
Look at aviation today. The recent statistics are that aviation flown by professional pilots and commercial airlines both globally and in the United States, is the safest that it has ever been since the introduction of commercial flight. That is the progress of 50 years of smart people, regulators, reproducible designs, competitive financing, lots and lots of learning, investigations, all those kinds of things. The fact of the matter is, you've put enough airplanes in the air, at least one of them is going to crash. But if you can then design it in such a way that crash didn't, you know, you improve it. And I think we have to get to that conversation. Yep. Facts actually do change. Data, we do actually learn things. Society does actually change. And I think as a result of this conversation, I'm now quite convinced that the problem is not a fact-based one, it's a trust-based one. That I think, Stewart, you said it right. You know, the dialogue really sort of named that. Because until there's some basic trust by the average person that the smart people, representing by you guys, are going to do the right thing, or the governments or something, we're going to be in this quagmire for in my view, far too long. And I think we have an opportunity with some of these new technological ideas to actually have a real breakthrough. It'd be nice if we actually got that, and we got it before we destroyed the planet.